Chief Secretary, Mr. Balakrishnan Dalal, Commissioner, and friends. I really appreciate the opportunity which you are giving me to come and talk at this Odisha Knowledge Hub event. I think it's a very remarkable thing to see a state like Odisha really looking at the knowledge economy much more as a driver towards jobs and economy, because in the next 25 years, knowledge is going to become the bigger contributor to growth and jobs than the infrastructure investments which we are making. And so I think I really appreciate you giving me the opportunity to share what global experiences are and what implications there are for Odisha. First, I would like to acknowledge that Odisha has made rapid strides, particularly in the last decade, on many fronts, whether it's the agriculture, whether it's the poverty reduction. I think you've done remarkable work in setting the foundation for inclusive growth and entrepreneurship. So I think all the preconditions which we know from global experiences exist in Odisha. So, but the question is that growth always does not translate into jobs. Income does not always translate into jobs. There's always something which you have to do in between to make sure that the growth gets translated into jobs. Agriculture alone is not going to solve the problem of jobs, but the way agriculture gets transformed will lead to non-farm jobs eventually. And so no country has been able to create jobs without really having a very strong agricultural growth, which is led by more by entrepreneurship. Then it transforms into a non-farm kind of growth. If you look at all the countries right now all over the world, whether we have look at our Southeast Asia, or even we look at Europe in terms of EU, or France or Holland, currently, 21% of the jobs still are coming from agriculture and food. But they're not coming from the agriculture production. They are coming from value addition, productivity, and food industry. So how does agriculture acquire industrial characteristics in terms of value addition processing is a very important issue to look at. And plus, the jobs have not been created by large companies. Jobs have always been created by missing middle, what we call it, which is the SMEs. The firms, the number of small and medium firms, if there are more, create more jobs. In USA, 69% jobs coming from small and medium enterprise. Holland, 71%. China, 61%. Thailand, 50%. So the main issue in the whole agriculture and rural scenario is how can we have now foundation of an enterprise economy where you have multiple nodes of entrepreneurship as opposed to only limited nodes of entrepreneurship. You have a big company somewhere, a big park somewhere, and the rest of it is only producers. If you have producers and you have only some people who are adding value, then jobs cannot be created. You have to have more people adding value on the value chain and on the whole ecosystem which creates jobs. Before coming, I looked at Odisha. I think you are on top in terms of most of the commodities there. I can show you that. I do this everywhere, that I look at where are you top 10 in top 10 category. In some of them, in globally also you are in top 10 actually, interestingly, not just in India. So a lot of the jobs also come more from non-cereal economy. Cereals can help you achieve food self-sufficiency, but it won't create more jobs. Although you can have more rice mills still in Odisha. You have less rice mills in Odisha compared to all the other states like Andhra and all. So what is just an example to show you where you have competitive advantage in terms of enough production volumes and growth. But if I look at where are you in job creation in each of these commodities, you are not on top 10. You are in the middle. So a lot of production doesn't get converted into jobs. So it means a lot of farmers are producing enough production, but they don't have opportunities for that production to be converted into enterprises and jobs. And this is the main issue right now. I think production can always increase. You can bring technology and production should always increase. But if you can see in the current last 6 months, after farmers produced so much, they didn't get any crisis. Okay? And that's the agrarian crisis we are facing right now in the country, that a lot of people still are not able to get remuneration or job multiplier from the production. And that's where people get disincentivized to produce more. Opportunities really in terms of agriculture production is no longer now serious. I think in India, from 2011, the non-cereal production is bigger than cereal production. If you take vegetables and trick fruits and all, now that production is already big because people have started diversifying quite a bit. But unlike cereals, I was just talking to Mr. Patil, Chief Secretary, also saying that cereals are taken care of, but the systems which we require for non-cereals to really develop markets, develop nodes of processing are limited. So I think that is a bigger challenge now for our country as a whole, but for Odisha as well, and how can you create new nodes of beyond production which will be more on value addition and processing. If you can create 1,000 clusters in Odisha, even meso level clusters on this part, each cluster is capable of producing almost 1,000 jobs. That's how jobs get created. I mean, jobs get created by clusters, jobs get created by entrepreneurs, jobs get created by what we increasingly call as missing middle. This issue is not with India only. Right? Most countries are finding it difficult to create this enterprise ecosystem. Because enterprise ecosystem doesn't necessarily get created only by government. It is the actual entrepreneurs which are there, and then there are other incentives of the other things which are there, which is the finance part of it, which is the kind of incubation part of it, where you need to now do more on creating enabling conditions for an enterprise ecosystem. Public good can play a catalytic role, but you have to have many other things in place there. Opportunities where jobs are getting created are in commercial milling and food processing, packaging, wholesaling, and then also logistics. Actually, logistics creates almost like world over one-third jobs in agriculture are created in logistics, which means you need to have good roads, but you need to think about logistic solutions, which is how trucks can move very fast, how they can transport things without, in terms of packaging, which is less kind of spillage is happening and all that kind of thing happening. So I think conventionally the agriculture departments have not looked at logistics as part of their role. So if an agriculture department has to now be in the business of agriculture, it is not in the business of cereals, it's in the business of other crops, and it has to be also in the business of processing and logistics. We have a lot of fragmentation in the way the state interacts with this agenda. One part interacts with production, another part interacts with processing, another part interacts with logistics. So we don't get a composite solution and a jobs coming in there. It takes a lot of time for an entrepreneur to get all these things right. And some entrepreneurs give up because these things don't come together. And even the entrepreneurs who take risk are not able to go further. But what I'm trying to say is that these are the sources of jobs. And finally is the mechanization. I think mechanization is very important for making the transition from agriculture to non-farm. Because mechanization does not happen adequately, you can see a lot of things remaining at that level, and people don't make the transition to non-farm because they are stuck at lower level of productivity. So I think the world over, we are now supporting firms. We are supporting a firm in Africa right now called Hello Tractor. What does it do? It's Uberized tractorization. Uberized tractor engine, which means if a small farmer wants 3 acres land to be tilled, there are tractor drivers who get a message like Uber and they reach his place, and then the money gets transferred into their account. Lot mechanization has doubled just by a small technical solution to that. So how do we think about mechanization? How do we bring in innovations and disruptions in mechanization creates enterprise opportunity? So every tractor driver in Africa is now getting $65 a day income, which is almost 5 times or 10 times higher than the average income which people are getting. They are leasing out these tractors, again like we lease out cars here, and then you go for that. So solutions are very, very different, and we are finding that there are no boundaries to these solutions. Younger people find solutions differently. We need to provide an ecosystem for younger people to be involved in finding solutions for agriculture, which will not be conventional, which will use some amount of ICT and that. So average age of farmers in our country is also very high. You know, it's 48, 49. I think the innovations in agriculture, if they have to happen in the next stage, we have to bring a lot of youth into agriculture, and we have to bring in innovation and disruption opportunities for younger people to find solutions in this area. Now you look at India also. It's not a question of Orissa. India is, you can see now, how much we are a part of the world market. We have many other countries like Brazil and all which are smaller than this in terms of, they create more jobs. China is almost equal to us in many of these things, creates more jobs. Now we have to ask this question, why in India, in spite of having a huge diversified production base, is not able to create jobs? And I think this is important to understand that we are almost 1/4 of the world production in most of the commodities. Now in case of milk, we clearly have an Amul, which was the social enterprise of its century, and it is now a $5 billion company, which is one of the few we have. But why don't we get more Amuls happening in our country? You know, you have to think about it, why it's not happening. Because Amul also did not come because of government. Because there was entrepreneurs who were provided an ecosystem to get it done. And so I think next set of mini Amuls in Orissa could be a possibility. I think you have many smaller units of $1 million, $5 million in Orissa, which have not taken the bigger leap because we haven't studied their problems and then looked at how we can support them there. There are many smaller firms in Orissa. I am looking at it, I have looked at the data. It's not that people are not trying, people don't have ideas, but we need to provide them an ecosystem which allows them to grow big. Now, food processing sector, we have quite a big food processing sector. We have, particularly on rice, we have more. Because I think there is a little bit more investment on the cereal side. That's why you have rice mills and other things. These are the job creators. Each of them is a job creator. The day this number increases, the food processing number increases, we will have plenty of jobs coming, not from just production, because the production will get eventually mechanized, but from processing and value addition. So that is very important. Now you look at EU. I'm talking only about food now. Okay, here, 310,000 companies working on food only, 4.8 million employees, 99% of the enterprises in food sector in EU are small and medium sized. This myth is that there is a big multinational company or something, it's not true. So Europe, if you look at Italy, you look at Spain, you look at all the food business is run by what you call it, the small and medium enterprises. You take France, champagne, cheese, all driven by smaller kinds of enterprises there. So it is evolution, even in countries which are growing and have a good industrial base, still have a strong SME food market. And if you go to a remote area in France, it's not a employment in a big company or an Aerobus or something. It is the employment in a small and medium enterprise which is creating jobs in remote areas. So somehow we feel that industrialization means that we have to completely just produce large companies and they will provide jobs to others. We don't realize that if we grow our small and medium enterprise sector in food and agriculture, this can become quite a big job creator. I'm not making a case that agriculture will not get transformed. After 25 years, it will not be a big contributor to GDP. But food, which is, if you know in India, food is considered part of manufacturing. It is not considered part of agriculture. That's why your data looks very distorted. If you include food manufacturing and all the industrial enterprises which are related to agriculture, you will find agriculture is still contributing 39% or 40% of the GDP. So this is also another policy level. We need to understand that agriculture gets transformed into food and acquires some industrial characteristics, and that's going to create more jobs than just pure production of agriculture. Now, this is the kind of ecosystem in South Asia. We have 99 million small and medium farmers in India. Okay. Then you have medium and large farmers. You have some producer organizations, but not like Amul. We don't have enough producer organizations. Aggregated number of percentage of farmers who are aggregated into some institutional framework of their own is hardly 3-4% in India. I think this is a big challenge that small farmers will face, that either they will disappear or they will have to aggregate. Then there are organized agribusiness companies. That number is also not very huge in India. But we have 40 million micro enterprises and we have 15 million SMEs. This is the current ecosystem if you look at India right now. You will be very surprised to know that these 40 million and 15 million are creating more jobs in agriculture than lots of other sectors. So each micro enterprise is capable of creating 4 to 5 jobs. Each SME is capable of creating 15 to 20 jobs. Now, we have too many micro enterprises, informal. They don't sort of get any kind of incentive regularly. Their finance is also problematic. Also, they are not recognized. They don't want to pay any taxes, obviously, because that's why they've remained micro for a very long, because they don't want to come under the tax radar, which is fair also. I personally feel that micro enterprises should not be taxed up to at least 1 crore, because otherwise how will new entrepreneurs come in if you start taxing them from day one? So I think this is the ecosystem we have. Now, this is one data which I wanted to share with you. This is the intensity of rural micro and small and medium enterprises. Now, this is total number of people employed in MSMEs versus total population of people in rural areas, which is how many people out of the people who are in that area are likely to be entrepreneurs. Now, clearly, overall rate for India is not very high. Well, obviously, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, we were talking about Gujarat just now to the Chief Secretary. I think he's right in saying that the propensity of becoming an entrepreneur in Tamil Nadu and Gujarat is higher and compared to Orissa. Orissa is doing still better than a lot of other states, I must say that. We are not in the bottom, we are in the middle there. But the whole business of jobs is, how do you increase this intensity? Why is Tamil Nadu creating more jobs? It is because its enterprise intensity is the highest. Why is Tirupur as a cluster, which is exporting 20,000 crores in Tamil Nadu? Because they have, over a period of time, supported creation of that ecosystem there. I personally feel that Odisha, in next decade, can go in this direction. I have no doubt in my mind, because I have met a lot of Odia entrepreneurs who are full of ideas and enthusiasm and all. But there is a feeling among a lot of people when I am talking Odisha, ki bhai, Odia log jo hai, wo enterprise mein nahi jayenge. You know, something like that people say, you know, no, we are happy with doing job or something like that. So they say it's a, like a behavioral or a cultural trait that we will not be able to weather. But I don't believe that. I think every state has started like that. Every state has started like that. But if you provide an enabling ecosystem, the propensity to go for an enterprise is higher. And we have to create a favorable ecosystem for people to think about an enterprise. Even if they fail, people should think about trying different things, and we should have enabling systems to do that. Easier said than done. It is not easy to do, but this is something you need to look at. Now, this is another set of data, which is state-wise establishment distribution with 10 or more workers. So you can see now what is the share of things. You can see Tamil Nadu. West Bengal also, interestingly, has 10 or more, but they don't pay them well. So it's not about more jobs, it's quality of jobs. Although West Bengal has more jobs, but they are not necessarily being paid. Workers are there because of unionization or whatever you call it, but they are not necessarily being paid huge amounts of money. So it is not about more jobs. Then you have Maharashtra, then you have Karnataka, and then you have others, and then obviously Odisha is there. But this should tell you something, that lot of people are not going for what I would call is a something between micro and small. So only 4.46% Odisha. So it is not, it is, Andhra is also low in that sense if you look at it. So this also you need to study a little bit. How can we encourage informal entrepreneurs to become formal? Informality is source of jobs, but very poor quality jobs. Formality is what creates good quality jobs. And it is difficult because we have so many informal people, enterprises, they are not graduating to formality. Now, this is a big challenge for many states like that. Some states have solutions for that. Now, I'll show you one agribusiness food sector. This is of how many people are employed in formal agriculture MSMEs versus total farmers, small and marginal farmers. Now, for each farmer, there are 5.6 people employed. In fact, agriculture, farming has become less, but the enterprise has become, you see now Thailand. Thailand was at the same stage 15 years back. As Thailand's data was exactly what your data was 15 years back. Now, what have they done? They have encouraged a lot of entrepreneurship happening around, say, mango. There are 26 products out of mango, including candies and all, which are being produced in Thailand by people who have very small businesses, and they package it and sell it. So on mango itself, you can see Thailand using a lot of products out of that, and a lot of entrepreneurs coming in there. Odisha has the same mango base, but we don't have products out, coming out of small industries and all technology and all there. But so you can see that job impact will be very fast if you encourage entrepreneurship. Imagine now 5.6 number of people employed per farmer, you know, from agriculture itself. It means agriculture is not only creating jobs for farmers, but is creating jobs for others also. So this is a very interesting, Thailand is a very illustrative case, and I would encourage you to really study this much more carefully, because I think you will get a lot of lessons that it is not an old story. It is these number of these Southeast Asian countries were exactly at the same stage about 20 years back or 15 years back. But they have invested differently. They have invested differently. Again, some data is from your data only, district-wise food and agriculture. You see some spatial pattern. You see certain areas which are very low on intensity of MSMEs. You have some which are medium, and obviously you have some areas which are high. And there are some reasons for it. I think though I can't go into this in great detail, but this shows you that picture is not uniform throughout Odisha. You have certain areas where already MSMEs are coming up. It will be good to build those areas further and make them the clusters. See, cluster starts like that. There's already some clustering happening there in the blue ones and green ones. Red ones, you need some bigger infrastructure investments to go there. They cannot automatically go to MSMEs. Non-farm employment in Odisha is rising, but more than half the workforce is still on the farm. So I think you are doing reasonably well on non-farm, and I have seen that lot of non-farm employment is increasing, but still you have half the people on the farm, but not necessarily on higher value intensive jobs, but on the lower level jobs. So the challenge is now how the people in the farm, even if they become less and go to non-farm, they should get better returns from the jobs which they are doing. Odisha's non-farm employment share is also below the national average right now. So you need to look at how you are comparing with other states. I'm not asking you to exactly be like other states, but come out with your own matrices of how you will measure jobs and jobs length. Because it's one of the things is that we even in India, we are not measuring investments with the jobs length most of the time. We are doing conventional financial analysis. But if you do the jobs analysis, you might come with different priority of investment. So I think I have seen every politician, every finance minister I have met always talks about jobs. Every minister I talk about jobs. But when we do our own analysis of priority of investments, we are not looking at jobs very critically. Now, just share with you now the global experiences. This is the second part of my thing. Now, how have jobs been created world over? There are many pathways. First pathway is through informal and formal SMEs. This is the biggest pathway. Largest number of jobs world over have been created by informal and formal SMEs. Now, that is something we have to realize, that we have to really invest in an enterprise ecosystem if we want more jobs. The second is through skills, incubation, and agropreneurs. This is now a very important thing, that in IT we have a lot of incubation and startup. But in agriculture and food, we don't have incubation happening at the same way as it's happening in IT. We don't have any hub for training people from idea stage to for agriculture and food. And so we are now working globally in many locations where exclusive incubators for agriculture and food are being developed, where people are taken from point A to point B. Younger people are taken also, who have more energy and enthusiasm, and new kinds of enterprises are coming in. So I think this thing about, we have current model of skills which NSDC and all do in our country, is about preparing people for employment in large companies. That's important. I think we need to skill. But I think the more important is now to prepare people for skilling on entrepreneurship. So basically what I'm saying is that there are pathways which are related with entrepreneurship, there are pathways related with skill and incubation. And then you have the third part is now we see a huge social enterprise movement in the world. A lot of people are coming into agriculture and food to have some kind of social enterprises there. So I think social enterprise example will be if you are trying to, this particularly the energy part, if you look at in our country, a lot of solar lighting is happening through people who are developing solar lighting as a business, as opposed to solar lighting as just a subsidy program or something, how you are developing an entrepreneurial content in whatever you do, energy, water, you know. So a lot of jobs will come through social enterprises as well. The fourth pathway which we have to look at is which happens with large and mid-sized agribusiness companies. So the value chains are large companies also can create jobs, provided we work on the whole value chain in such a way that we create jobs on the way. So you have companies in like ITC or Olam and all, who are developing their business value chains in such a way that they are upgrading capacity of farmers, entrepreneurs on the way, and their supply chain is in such a way that it creates skills and jobs on the way. So you could also create jobs with large agribusiness companies. Some of the things which I think the other states have started doing, and I think maybe Odisha is also doing, is that, see, Walmart came to Andhra Pradesh and it wanted 7 stores to be opened. So Mr. Naidu said, we will give you 7 licenses only if you train all the rural women who are retailers in inventory management and bring all your best practices on retail. And you have to do 1 year corporate social responsibility of training all the rural retailers, then I'll give you licenses. So it's like an interesting models which are coming in, that you are making investments contingent on some kind of role you have to play in creating social responsibility. So it's they need investment. People want to come to Orissa in any case, but if you can have a simple framework by which they will have to demonstrate, not by just financial proposals, but by the way what they do in 6 months or 1 year in terms of building capacity of that sector, that would be an interesting thing to do. And that creates jobs in a very different way. Their supply chains get changed, not by the traditional agent model, the trader model, but by a different kind of model. So now, the in the entrepreneurship pathway also, you have many ways of going for it, basically. I was telling the Chief Secretary some time back that you cannot start SMEs from day one. You need to create a pipeline of micro-enterprises. World over, it's happened like that. The micro-enterprises, after taking some kind of a risk, then graduate into SMEs. So Odisha can start a micro-enterprise kind of building system. And in fact, all the credit which is coming from various schemes, SFGs and all, it is leading to some kind of micro-enterprises. But we don't have a system to capture those micro-enterprises and take them to the next level. Lot of them are waiting, you know, they're looking for an opportunity. So basically, you need now a system by, you can become, you don't have to take the route of having SMEs. You can create maybe how many self-help groups we have and how many other things we have created huge amount of social capital at the lower level, out of which you can at least have 300 to 500,000 people who have the potential to become micro-entrepreneurs. So you could create, Bangladesh has done this. Bangladesh is the largest, Bangladesh's micro-enterprise intensity is higher than ours, because they have been supporting those micro-entrepreneurs as opposed to only micro-credit for a long time. So the change is that rather than focusing only on micro-credit, you have to focus on micro-entrepreneurship and create the next generation of first-time entrepreneurs who will come from those kinds of households. From those micro-entrepreneurs, you will create a pipeline for people who will become SMEs. If you invest in this system for next 5 years, I think you will have a high intensity of SMEs also. After a decade, you will be sitting on the largest enterprise economy if you go through this kind of route. This is one pathway which many countries have adopted. Their SMEs don't come up overnight, because our systems are not geared towards that. But if you come through micro-enterprises, you can go to SMEs faster. Then I think the second part I think you look at is this whole thing about skills, which has become like a body shop creation for large companies. I think we need to develop incubation centers all across. We are working right now in Tamil Nadu and many other states on developing grassroots incubation centers where it is like you enroll 1,000, 2,000 youth, make them go through from idea stage to enterprise stage and provide a single window of kind of financing and other things there. If you can create this kind of incubation centers at the level of tier 3 and 4 cities primarily, because tier 1 and 2 cities, there is a different model of entrepreneurship. Tier 3, 4 cities and block headquarters, if they have a physical space where hundreds of people can sit together, it's like Silicon Valley, but applied to agriculture and food. You know, why is Silicon Valley doing well? Because in one building, six floors, there are 5,000 entrepreneurs sitting, tossing ideas at each other, presenting to each other, funders also come there, and that's how things change completely. But we are now going to try this approach in some states and see how it works. And we are keen that if you want this to be tried out in Orissa, we are really very keen to work with you on creating this foundation of grassroots incubation through that process. The technical and vocational education and training is also a very neglected part of it. We have a lot of ITIs, we have a lot of vocational training, but it's considered as a kind of second grade or third grade kind of thing. I think vocational education, which means what are the sectors? Processing, technology, storage, cold chain. These have huge potential in creating vocational skills. And eventually when people learn these skills, they become entrepreneurs on these skills also. But because we have very less number of people who know about these kinds of technologies and these elements, those vocational base is very strong. Reason that Germany is a leader in manufacturing, they have the best vocational education system in the world. They give more weightage to vocational education than engineering right now. That's why they have a lot of technical people who is the background for manufacturing there. I think we can create and replicate those elements in agriculture and food. We don't have a strong vocational educational element in agriculture and food right now, and rural areas in general. So this is also something we need to look at. We have to take some ITIs and transform them into agriculture and food ITIs. This is also something we should look at very seriously. And finally, our agriculture universities should really train people to become entrepreneurs as opposed to becoming the job seekers in a government department or something. So that's also something, a big change we require. You can see now what China is doing. One practice you would like to learn about is that they have this system of Taobao villages. Taobao, which is Alibaba, basically is helping any small entrepreneur in any part of China producing even small quantities of goods to be able to catalog their things and put it on the e-commerce site where anyone from the world can buy their products. I know I have bought stuff from Alibaba entrepreneurs myself, you know. And I think this will revolutionize the way the face-to-face marketing will work in future, basically. So I think this is something we need to look at. And since Alibaba is also coming, I think there are China-India relations are a little bit, you know, down at this stage. So I don't know whether we'll be able to do it at this stage, but Alibaba has invested in Paytm. They are very keen that they would like to work with a group of small entrepreneurs to create a market channel for them. We are working with Amazon, Flipkart, Co-op. So e-commerce is also an area where these small entrepreneurs can leapfrog the conventional problems they are facing in terms of going through a very long supply channel. And if they put their products out there, somehow they are able to access markets at one-tenth the cost at which they are accessing right now. So this also is something we need to look at. Now, your own example in your backyard, which I'm going to go and see now in the evening, but I have collected some data on that. We have Mayurbanj, the producer company, which has really taken mango production and aggregated from all small producers, basically 6,000 growers, mostly women particularly, and they did 864 tons of mango this year, in 3 months itself. It's a pilot even now at this stage, and 2.5 crores turnover, you know. And they have created 15 full-time and 397 part-time jobs in this enterprise already. Imagine if we multiply Mayurbanj by 100 times, you are on to a different job scenario than what you have done there. I personally will go and collect more information and data, so the next time I can give you more, and I can use your example in other places also. You see, Orissa has already created a mango. The interesting part is, I think our colleagues in OLM have done a remarkable job, is that they have not stuck to one sort of market. They have gone to Mother Dairy, they have gone to Big Basket, they are even selling retail in a lot of industrial buyers and all. They have created their own brand of how the Mayurbhanj mango can be sold. See, it is about branding, it's about clustering, it's about aggregating. It's not rocket science, I would say. But somehow we think that market means a traditional market by which you access things in a particular kind of way. So I think they are going to now try the same approach in ginger. And you have organic ginger in Orissa. Orissa is the biggest source. You have the best organic ginger in the world. And I think if you identify certain commodities and just organize the farmers, this is a request to the agriculture department, that we spend a lot of time on production and productivity. We need a market-based kind of model where producer organizations and all can be developed, and then you can work on that as you go along. Finally, I think there are many countries trying other things. I will not go into it in detail. So this is the Mayurbhanj example where, you know, I was told yesterday that the train which takes mangoes from this used to stop only for 5 minutes. Now it stopping for 7 minutes now. That you made the trains because of that cluster stop for 2 minutes more. See the power of the aggregation to get the market working for you. And railways said we will put more rakes, we'll stop train more. If you have more nodes of aggregation, then we will make sure that the railway starts getting goods traffic from there. So I think this is something very interesting. This is just a very small example of what 1,000 ton can do. But you are sitting on 800,000 tons of mango. If you really took this commodity seriously, its potential to create jobs is phenomenal. And then we are not still talked about processing. If you start processing mango, create pulp, create candies and all, then the potential is even more. So I would urge at least us to give it a shot in certain commodities and try these approaches and then study what is the jobs impact. And if necessary, we can provide the enabling conditions for that. These don't require huge resources. They don't require huge resources. It's just the enabling environment and the way you capacitate people, the producers, to become marketers and get market information, have an app on mango for that. You know, you can have an app by which people get prices. So you can really work on that value chain much better. It's not going further. Can you push it? My thing is not working. I just want to close in the next 5 minutes, so otherwise I'll look at my thing and close, yeah. Okay. So now you can see globally, thank you. So this is the Krishnagiri Tamil Nadu cluster, which came at the same time. You know, that cluster is employing 250,000 people direct and indirect now in Krishnagiri. That also started in the same way as Mayurbhanj has started, basically. So I think the potential of these clusters is very huge, very huge. And I think agriculture food has not benefited from clusters for quite some time. Now, you clearly see some other countries what they are following. Now, Taiwan is using the one town, one product model, which Japan has that model, and a lot of countries have copied that model. That, you know, that town is known for that one product, basically. One town, one product, one village, one product, something like that, you know. So this is one approach which many countries are trying. Government of Italy is full of small artisanal kind of thing. Italy is a very different country than Europe, normally in Europe. It has the business network contract which facilitate a private agreement between one or two companies. So firms collaborate to reduce costs and then compete on some things, but collaborate on some things. So very interesting. China has productivity promotion centers for SMEs. It's like every 50 kilometers you will find a productivity promotion center where SMEs can walk in and they can look at technologies and get access to that. See, this is a doorstep facility which we need for SMEs. Those SMEs, if they go on their own to everywhere, they will never be able to compete in the market because the costs will become very prohibitive. These are just some approaches which are there. France has this auto entrepreneur statute in which you don't have to register. If you're an entrepreneur, you just register yourself. You don't have any formal registration. And since they have done that, they have 300,000 new micro enterprises. So even in France, if you make auto registration, a lot of new people start coming in. So in South Africa, you have a big small enterprise development agency, which is a facilitating agency. The state has that agency there. Just not going forward. Just one more slide. Okay. I want to, in Germany, again, the skilled labor concept. Singapore, the tax model in which they have a lot of incentives for people not to pay taxes until they become really from micro to SMEs. There are a lot of things where, and they also have an 850 million enterprise development fund. So state has to play a role here. I personally feel that micro enterprise, its state requires a more enabling environment in the beginning. But once you do it, after 3 or 4 years, financing comes from private sources. So summing up, I would like to just say that we need to create an ecosystem for farm and non-farm enterprise promotion. Okay, I'll show you that the other states also are there. Yeah. Okay. So you have Kerala has a startup village concept of business incubator, public private center, but it's primarily in technology, not on food. But the same concept can be bought in case of food because nothing stops us from doing that. And government of Maharashtra has reduced power tariff for SMEs so that they don't pay the same power charges there. West Bengal has developed a web-enabled common application gateway where MSMEs can register directly, don't have to go to a registration office. It's a completely web-enabled. And Gujarat is giving, below 35 years, is giving additional interest subsidies to young entrepreneurs. So these are not exhaustive, I'm just giving a flavor of what different, because they're thinking about this category. So I think you need a policy which thinks about small and medium enterprises and young enterprises and agriculture and food. I think it deserves some kind of a policy focus. Now, in conclusion, I think you are on to a very good production base. I don't think Orissa can keep on working on production time immemorial. That's not the issue. I think now it's the question of how you can convert your production into entrepreneurship. That's the biggest thing. So I think if you can provide some kind of an ecosystem for that, which means you have some facilitation agency which is focused on, you have an MSME department and everything, I've seen what it does. But MSME departments have become a way of channeling funding. That's it, subsidies and this. But not about creating that environment in which you are able to get a lot of people to come and come with their ideas. You need a platform which focuses, which makes, gives people this message that entrepreneurs can come in with their ideas and all. Also, focus on value addition and processing. Take some commodities and say, okay, we will move to value addition processing there, and then mostly for non-serial, non-PDS, because serial PDS is taken care of. You don't have to mess with that. That system is working well. So you have to work on those other commodities. Grassroots incubators like this, tier 3-4 city incubators for youth and apprenticeship program. We need to get a lot of young people to apprentice with the enterprises so that no one becomes an entrepreneur without becoming an apprentice. World over, 90% of entrepreneurs first work for someone, find out the idea, then beat the guy also because they are more entrepreneurial than the guy whom they are working for. So I think the apprenticeship is very important. The institutional framework and policy framework is important. I don't think you should give too much resources. It's more about creating the institutional platform, capacity, mechanism, resources. Entrepreneurs don't become entrepreneurs because of resources. They become entrepreneurs because of scarcity of resources. Please understand that. So we, government, have sometimes this feeling that we need to give. World Bank also has the same thing. Just give money. Money is not going to create entrepreneurship. It's non-financial investment which is going to. Then the innovative financial products. You could announce a venture fund from the state, just $10 million, and see what does it do. You know, not huge amounts of money. That will give a message that the state is looking at different modes of financing rather than subsidy, which is more like a venture capital thing like that. I'll stop at that. There are many things to share, but I am very optimistic about Orissa's ability to do that. I have met a lot of Orissa residents and all my travels all across the world. They are as entrepreneurial as anyone. I don't buy that question. They are not entrepreneurial. I personally feel they are entrepreneurial. It's just the ecosystem which we provide them. You could become the biggest kind of enterprise, micro-enterprise incubator in the world. I encourage you to go there. Thank you very much.